Yeah, so we've already seen a small introduction about tissue culture. This is just brushing up, where you have these are the basic methodology or the techniques which you use normally in any plant tissue culture laboratory. We have it goes in the hierarchy of preparation of the medium and then selection of the explant. I've told you, explant is any part of the any bit of the plant, healthy plant. Then you have to sterilize the explants using surface sterilization methods. You can use sodium hypochlorite or mercury chloride, and then followed by washing with sterile distilled water. And then late after that, we normally do the inoculation, which is called transfer of the explant to a suitable medium under aseptic condition. You can use, normally for explant, we use a solid culture. For callus transfer, we can make use of a solid culture as well as a suspension culture. Then we move on to incubation of the inoculant. We have to incubate it under optimal conditions of light, temperature and humidity. And the 16 hours of photo period will vary with different cultures. When you use a shoot tip or a root tip or a bud or a meristematic tissue, it differs with what you are actually growing. If you want a callus, it will be a different photo period. If you want an embryo, it will be a different photo period. So differs with the type of the explant, type of the callus, and type of morphogenesis you want to get. Then after all these things, basic techniques, we go in for regeneration, where hardening is done. Like, you have to gradually expose the tissue cultured plantlets to different increasing temperatures, from the room temperature, I mean from the 22 degrees or 25 degrees to slowly 26, 27, 30, and then the field temperature. So that is called hardening. So there you regenerate the whole plant from the callus to production of roots, production of shoots, production of embryos, and then go in for hardening. Then after that, the final step is transferring it from the greenhouse to the field conditions. So this is basic methodology of any tissue culture method. This aseptic condition is the most important part of tissue culture, cultivation of plants by tissue culture method. So here everything has to be sterilized. Either it is total sterilization, absolute sterilization, or surface sterilization. So when you talk about surface sterilization, all living materials, all heat labile, those which get inactivated when high temperature is applied on it, all such materials have to be surface sterilized. So plant materials, tissues, all these are normally surface sterilized. Otherwise, equipments, culture media has to be sterilized properly, absolute sterilization, that is totally free of organisms. The room as such has to be sterilized. Actually, you normally fumigate the room using formaldehyde or any other chemical which will make the room free of microorganisms. So for equipments, metal equipments, for glass materials, normally you have studied about the various sterilization techniques. We make use of dry heat, wet heat. For culture media, for certain sterilizing certain sugar solutions or antibiotic solutions or vitamin solutions or hormones, we make use of filtration technique. We cannot use heat in that condition. We make use of ultrafiltration, and chemicals are also used for the sterilization process. Some amount of chemical level sterilization is also done. And surface sterilization, you can use a hypochlorite solution, sodium hypochlorite or calcium hypochlorite. Only difference is the percentage, the concentration. Then the materials have to be, after the dipping it in sodium hypochlorite or calcium hypochlorite, it has to be totally washed with sterile water so as to remove the chemicals, sterilants. And then you can also make use of hydrogen peroxide solution. You can make use of bromine water or chlorine water, mercury chloride. Normally in laboratory conditions, for practical purposes, we make use of mercury chloride, but actually mercury chloride is also being banned now. Silver nitrate is very costly. You can make use of antibiotics, but you cannot be sure of removing all the organisms. Absolute alcohol is the best thing, but it cannot be used for all the normal explants. You cannot use absolute alcohol because it will totally dehydrate the material. So only for woody tissues you can make use of absolute alcohol. So these are some of the techniques which you have already studied. So for what method is used for sterilizing what kind of equipments? So you make use of chemical sterilants, you make use of dry heat method, you make use of wet heat method for glassware culture media and the conditions for wet heat, ultrafiltration for all liquid media which are unstable at high temperature. Antibiotics have to be added for preventing microbial growth after the tissue culture medium is prepared. Chemicals have to be used like rectified spirit or surgical spirit to disinfect the working area. And then environment sterilization, like the room can be sterilized by using any kind of fumigation, any kind of chemical fumigants you can make use of. But now we make use of laminar airflow to work with the tissue culture. So as I already told you, for the sterilization room is very important aseptic condition for tissue culture laboratory, for any tissue culture laboratory. Now when we come to the next part is this nutrient medium. You all know medium is a composition or a collection of nutrient solutions which help in the growth of any kind of living cell. So media is normally composed of inorganic matter, organic nutrients, other substances. pH is very important for any nutrient medium. So inorganic nutrients, you have micronutrients and macronutrients. Like NPK is macro, micro, boron, copper, iron, manganese, zinc, all which is required in very, very minute amounts in microliter concentration. So micronutrients are needed only in micro units. Macronutrients, you have to provide them in high amounts because macronutrients make the primary metabolites, like all the nucleic acid for the production of, for the synthesis of nucleic acid, for the synthesis of enzyme, for the synthesis of cells, you need macronutrients. So they have to be given in a larger concentration. So organic nutrients are also very important. You need vitamins, B1, B6, B3, B5, thiamine, nicotine, biotin. Okay, and then essential amino acids are also required for any plant tissue culture. And otherwise also you need some carbon sources like glucose or maltose for the initial growth. You need to provide glucose. Without glucose or without any carbon source, you will not have any kind of growth starting. Then you need growth hormones or regulators, definitely. Without this, you can only get callus. If you want a rootlet or a shootlet, you need to have hormones. Otherwise, you will only be left with callus. So auxin cytokinin is very important. Gibberellins, ethylene and abscic acid play a very minor role. Actually, sometimes they play an inhibitory role also, actually. So auxins and cytokinins are the most important hormone requirements for tissue culture media. Gibberellins, yes, to some extent, but these two are more harmful than useful in tissue culture media because they both are involved in senescence, both are involved in inhibiting the growth. So specific reasons for some specific growth, maybe you will need abscisic acid. Otherwise, generally for any plant tissue culture, you don't need these two. Then apart from this, you need protein hydrolysate, yeast extract, that is easily available nutrients. Sometimes you can also make use of natural media. You can make use of banana extracts, you can make use of coconut milk, you can make use of carrot juice, tomato juice. So even if you don't have all these inorganic nutrients or organic nutrients, you can use a natural medium for the initial stages, for the callus development. And then definitely you need a solidifying agent like agar, alginate. It is very important. EDTA, ethylene diamine, tetraacetic acid is a very important chelating agent. It actually makes available the metal ions to the growing tissues, like metal ions like copper, iron, all these are micronutrients. So when you add EDTA into the medium, it makes available, it absorbs the metal ions from the nutrient medium and supplies it to the growing tissue. So it acts as a chelating agent. It traps the metal ions and supplies it to the growing tissue. So apart from that, definitely you need antibiotics, because you the whole condition should be maintained in an aseptic. Then the, definitely the important thing about the incubation is the pH of the medium. When you talk about the growth medium, the pH is very important. It should be in the range of 5.6 to 6 before autoclaving the culture medium, because it might reduce a bit after autoclaving. So there, you know, if you just make it a point that it is 5.6 after autoclaving, you will see it is 5.5. And that means 5.5 is the optimal pH limit. So always after autoclaving, the pH will reduce to a certain extent. This also again depends on what medium you're using, what kind of ingredients you're using for growing what kind of tissues. So slight changes will be there, but generally it is around 6.5. Now the functions of the medium, we have seen the importance of the medium. First function is providing water, providing the mineral nutrients, providing vitamins, growth regulators, atmosphere for gas exchange, access to atmosphere for gas exchange, and removal of plant metabolite waste. So this is also very important. As you give all these things, medium also has to take care of the removal of plant metabolite waste, which can be removed by frequent changes in the nutrient medium. So for weekly subculturing into a fresh nutrient medium will always remove the plant metabolite waste, which is because the tissue which you are growing is very, very vulnerable to a slight change in the environmental condition, because it is just a group of cells without any protective coat or a protective, you know, it is all our, I mean, all our meristematic like cells, which are very, very soft and vulnerable. So you need to remove plant metabolite waste very frequently, you know, to prevent toxicity. So the callus will dry up. If you don't subculture frequently, the callus will dry up. It will become brown and it will dry up. When you talk about the media, it is the basic of the medium, which is the source of energy. You have a carbon source, nitrogen source. These two are the most important source of energy. Among the carbon, you can make use of sucrose, fructose, lactose, maltose, and starch. Nitrogen source, you have defined nitrogen and undefined nitrogen. Defined nitrogen is synthetic. Undefined is actually more natural. You don't actually know the composition of the source. In this defined nitrogen source, you know actually it is because it is inorganic. Ions are there, amines are there, ammonium is there, nitrate ions are there. Then you have glycine. Actually, you can add glutamine. You can add the amino acid. You will know the composition of the amino acid, how much you are adding. But in undefined, you don't know exact composition. Coconut milk or carrot juice, potato, tomato juice. And then we saw aloe vera juice, banana extract. All these come under undefined nitrogen source. So these few slides are going to talk about what exactly each inorganic nutrient or organic nutrient is having, what kind of function it is having. You know, essentially about 15 elements are required for whole plant growth. Macronutrients like nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, calcium, magnesium, and sulfur. So you know, for nitrogen, potassium, phosphorus are all primary metabolites. Calcium, very important, magnesium for chlorophyll synthesis, and sulfur for all the amino acid requirements. Because sulfur is very important, because the first amino acid is methionine. It is required for every kind of metabolic actions, for all kinds of DNA replication, enzyme synthesis, and all kinds of metabolite synthesis, all kinds of anabolic reactions. You need mRNA, tRNA, protein synthesis. So for protein synthesis, methionine is the first amino acid which is brought, you know, for any kind of protein synthesis. So sulfur, methionine contains sulfur. So sulfur is very, very important. And then these are, you know, nitrogen is important in DNA, proteins, chlorophyll. All these are already known to you. Similarly, organic nutrients, also you have organic nitrogen in the form of, you know, yeast extract, beef extract, meat extract, all these have organic nitrogen. Apart from that, you have vitamins which are required, thiamine, niacin, myoinositol, cyanocobalamin. So all these, you know, these are required for general plant tissue culture techniques. But in this, any one is enough. You don't have to add all. You don't have to add all cyanocobalamin, nicotinic acid, thiamine, ellame. You don't have to add. For specific requirements, you can choose what is the kind of callus tissue you are growing, how much nutrient it requires. Depending on that, you can choose the organic as well as inorganic nitrogen source. Amino acids are important, definitely. Some cultured plant cells can synthesize all the amino acids, but some require artificially. It has to be used up, like casein hydrolysate is very easily assimilable organic nitrogen, like glutamine, asparagine. All these are essential amino acids, very simple amino acids, which are added to boost up the growth of callus. Sometimes they can also be inhibitory to the cell growth. So, for example, if you want to stimulate morphogenesis, like shoot development or root development or leaf development, normally they make use of tyrosine, which stimulates morphogenesis. But there's a hitch that can be used only in a solid medium, because solid medium, it doesn't allow the required molecule to immediately access by the callus. So slowly only it releases. So that advantage is there when you use a solid medium. But when you use a liquid medium, immediately the cells are surrounded by the nutrients. So even if they are in excess, it can be inhibitory to them. But in solid medium, it will release, the nutrients will get released slowly only. So it will not harm the growing culture. So that is why they say solid medium is better. So L-tyrosine stimulates shoot formation. Then you have arginine sulfate, which can stimulate cell growth. Okay. And then these are the amino acids. When carbon source, normally carbohydrates are used in tissue culture as an energy source. So normally they, because they are not autotrophic, you cannot expect a callus to synthesize its own photosynthate, because it is still young and vulnerable. It has not yet formed the chlorophyll containing cells. So they are normally non-autotrophic. So they entirely depend on external source of carbon. So sucrose, fructose, and glucose. They are the most commonly used carbon. Maltose, raffinose. So they have also done some research and they have shown that dicot roots grow better with sucrose, whereas monocots grow better with glucose. So all these, there are other carbohydrates also which can be used depending on what you are growing. Growth hormones are definitely important. Success of plant tissue culture will depend on the amount of growth hormone. So most important ones are auxins, cytokinins, and gibberellins. Normally, even though ethylene and abscisic acid are used as growth hormones, they vary considerably with their endogenous levels. Some plants or some cells, they synthesize the growth hormones as they grow with the help of the nutrients which are present in the medium. But depending on what type of culture is growing, we have to add externally certain hormones. So apart from auxins, gibberellins, cytokinins, they also, you make use of polyamines, jasmonates, salicylates, which are also used as growth hormones, which are precursors of growth hormones. We can call them precursors of growth hormones. So when you add these organic substances in the medium, the plants make their own growth hormones at their own concentration level. So plant growth regulators, that's a small slide which shows the function of the hormones. Auxins, you know, they stimulate cell elongation. You have natural and synthetic. Indolastic acid, naphthalenastic acid, and 2,4-D. Gibberellins elongate internodes. This comes in the later stages. Normally in callus or the explant stages, you don't need gibberellin. Yeah, cytokinins promote cell division. So you need definitely for callus stage. Cell elongation and cell division are, you know, they are hand in hand. After a cell elongates, it starts dividing. So auxin and cytokinins are the most important hormones. Now these slides are only going to tell you about a little bit about the auxins. You have already studied all these things, how it helps in growth expansion and cell wall elongation. Okay, and they sometimes, in when you talk about callus culture or expansion culture on organized tissue, normally auxins cause root formation. But which are normally used in tissue culture is indole 3-acetic acid. Other auxins are also available, indole-3 butyric acid, chloroindole-3 acetic acid. These are also used in tissue culture. So other synthetic auxins are NAA and 2,4-D. Cytokinins are definitely useful because they stimulate the cell division. And normally cell division is regulated by joint action of auxin and cytokinin. So there has to be a ratio of auxin-cytokinin to be maintained in the culture medium. Only then you will get a proper morphogenesis. Okay, so auxins affect DNA replication, whereas cytokinins exert events leading to mitosis, that is cell division, cellular division. Here it is DNA replication, cytokinin leads to cellular division, cytokinesis. Okay, so the most commonly used cytokinins are kinetin, which is very, very commonly used in tissue culture, or BA, benzyl adenine. Zeatin is also very common. And normally, cytokinin, natural cytokinin, we make use of when we use coconut water. So it is rich in natural cytokinins. This is the what I told you, auxin-cytokinin ratio is very important. So if you want callus alone, then intermediate ratio. If you want shoot formation, it has to be low auxin to cytokinin ratio. So auxin amount will be less, cytokinin will be slightly raised. If you want root formation, high auxin to cytokinin ratio. That means auxin amount will be high, cytokinin ratio will be lower comparatively. So by regulating the amount of auxin and cytokinin, you can maintain a callus for a longer time. You can maintain it in the callus form for a longer time. So this is very important for tissue culture. Apart from this, gibberellin and abscisic acid, they are not so much important in tissue culture, because cultured callus cells synthesize their own gibberellin. So once the callus is formed, they can synthesize their own gibberellins because the precursors are already available in the nutrient medium. But abscisic acid is normally, you know, they are produced by the plants itself when the cells age, when the cells start aging, because each cell has a cell cycle. When the cell cycle comes to the end stage, the cells start producing abscisic acid by themselves. So naturally, you don't add abscisic acid to the plant tissue because it will accelerate aging and it will not be beneficial to tissue culture. So auxin promotes root growth and cell division. Cytokinin promotes shoot growth and cell division. Gibberellin promotes cell enlargement and shoot elongation. It comes at a slightly later stage. And abscisic acid is a stress hormone, inhibits auxin. Ethylene, low concentration can promote, or higher concentration will inhibit effect. So these two, ethylene and abscisic acid, we don't have to bother with regards to tissue culture. Apart from these substances, you have other yeast extracts and banana extracts. Phenolic compounds are important when you are talking about morphogenesis, shoot morphogenesis or root morphogenesis. You need to add phenolic compounds. Activated charcoal is used as a detoxifying agent. When we spoke about removal of plant toxins, this is important. When you add, it becomes important to add activated charcoal in the medium. We have to optimize it. Everything concentration has to be optimized before adding. So it removes the plant wastes from the tissues. Metabolic wastes can be removed. And then this concentration of charcoal has to be optimized, as I told you, 0.3% or lower. Okay. And it demineralizes the water. Why charcoal is used, no? It demineralizes the water. Water used for tissue culture studies are ionic water, deionized water, they say. Absolutely, there should be no mineral in water which you use for tissue culture. So in that case, if there are any minerals also, if you add activated charcoal, they get adsorbed onto them. So it enhances the media quality for tissue culture. Lastly, you have solidifying agents. Normally, it improves the oxygen supply because it doesn't give oxygen immediately. It is slow release of oxygen, supports the culture growth. There is a support in the substratum where the culture can stick to the substratum and grow. So that advantage is there. So strong gelling capacity is added. Normally any kind of agar medium or agarose medium can be used. Agar, alginate, carrageenan, gelatin, starch, silica gel, hydroxyethyl cellulose and polyacrylamide, depending on what is the tissue you are working with. Agar is extraordinarily resistant to enzymatic hydrolysis. So only few bacteria exist. Anyway, few bacteria means some bacteria may be there which are capable of producing degrading enzyme. That is, there are no bacteria which degrades agar till now. You find bacteria growing in agar, but they don't degrade agar as such. So the gelling capacity will be there. But only thing is contamination might come. The important thing is EDTA, ethylene diamine tetraacetic acid, which is used as an iron source. Iron is a micronutrient. pH, I have already told you. Antibiotics, normally we make use of carbamazepine and augmentin. Okay, for laboratory purposes, we make use of amoxicillin, whichever is easily available. But normally when you are really seriously thinking about tissue cultures and growing plant tissue culture, make use of carbamazepine and augmentin. The types of media, you have few types. For in your syllabus, you have MS medium and B5. Murashige and Skoog medium and B5 medium. So this is the Murashige, which is in vitro callus culture. They worked with Nicotiana tabacum and used it for regeneration of callus culture. It's a basal media. That means it is used only for callus regeneration. So it has a high concentration of nitrate, potassium and ammonium. So nitrogen source in the form of nitrates and ammonium and potassium. Total ion concentration is 5-fold higher than the previously used media. And the potassium concentration, based on the nitrate, potassium and ammonium concentration. Here again, Gamboge medium, B5 medium. Again for callus culture. Again for callus culture as well as cell suspension culture. Glycine Max soybean, they have worked with soybean suspension culture. And it also contains greater proportion of nitrate and potassium, but low concentration of ammonia. So that is the only difference between MS and B5. So these this slide gives you the, any book, any biotech book will have the inorganic constituents of MS medium. This is, okay. So these are the inorganic constituents of MS medium. And these are the inorganic constituents of B5 medium. Okay, so now I have already told you what are the different types of inorganic constituents and organic constituents and what are the functions. And I have also explained about the different requirements. What are the importance of the media constituents? Okay, and you have to see, this is only a, I'm giving you a gist. I'm uploading this in the Google Classroom. Okay.